Hi, everyone, and Happy New Year. Welcome to episode 64 of the Victory Podcast, where we talk about life, leadership, and journey. I'm your host, Amy Forsyth. We're so excited to resume our sessions, and we kick off the new year with a guest who I've had my eye on for a long time, and I know you're going to enjoy hearing about his leadership journey and what important work he's doing now after retiring from the Army as a decorated Green Beret. Meet Darrell Utt. From humble beginnings in West Virginia, Darrell overcame great odds by hard work and sacrifice. From earning the coveted Ranger tab and Green Beret to leading teams in combat, Darrell was selected to be the Chief of Business Operations for the new National Medal of Honor Museum Foundation in Arlington, Texas. Darrell retired from U.S. Army Special Forces in January 2017, and during his service, he was awarded the Bronze Star Medal with Valor for heroic actions and leadership during combat operations in Baghdad, Iraq in 2006. He's been recognized for several other awards, which you can read about in his bio, and we're going to talk more about tips for a successful life, hear what advice he would give someone who's just starting their career, and what other big projects he's working on in the new year. Welcome to the show, Darrell. It's great to finally connect with you.
Yeah, happy 2024 to everyone, and we've definitely been trying to connect, and I'm glad that we're finally able to do this. It's been a lot of back and forth, so I'm fired up to be here and fired up to talk to you and fired up for the audience.
Absolutely. I've been following your story on social media and really tuned in to what you're doing. You're coming to us from Texas. So can you tell us a little bit about your position and what you're up to these days?
Yep. So I'm the Chief of Operations at the National Medal of Honor Museum Foundation. It's a three-pronged project. We're building a museum. Part of that museum is going to be a leadership institute, and then we'll eventually be building a monument in Washington, D.C. So we're super excited about that. I've been part of the foundation for 2 years now, and we are moving forward quickly towards our grand opening, even though it's March 2025, so it's still a little over a year away. But I have a little bit of experience with opening up another museum and a grand opening. And I know the last year just goes by, it flies by so quickly. So yeah, I feel very fortunate that I was able to kind of match my passion and supporting veterans and doing all those things and kind of match up, you know, what I am passionate about with the foundation. So just super, super stoked and really looking forward to opening up the museum.
Wow, we are too. And we've heard about this on the news. We've seen, you know, national level reporting on it. And it is going to be a national treasure. And you are at the forefront of that. So we'll check back with you later on progress and support you every way we can. But let's talk about your leadership journey. So as a Green Beret, a Special Forces guy, you had an amazing career with an epic journey. Take us back to where it started for you, where you grew up and then what led you to joining the Army.
Sure. My journey started in a little small town, Huntington, West Virginia. 60,000 some people, super blue collar, hardworking, patriotic Americans. So, I played all the sports growing up, and fortunately, in high school, my football coach was a National Guard Green Beret, Coach Thornburg. And I give him shouts out on a lot of my podcasts and my people back in Huntington that listen in. So I'll say hi to them now. But that's where it all began. And, I came from humble beginnings. So there weren't a lot of options for me, like a lot of my classmates might have had. So the military made a lot of sense. And then, of course, Coach Thornburg really encouraged not only me, but several of the football players. And fortunately, a lot of them did go on and serve. I think that's really important. You know what that's like, Amy. You served as well. So I think it's an important thing to do. And a lot of us did go on and serve. And I entered the Army in July of 1990, and I started out as an infantry guy. Went to Fort Benning, Georgia for basic and AIT. And then my first duty station was out in California, actually, was Fort Ord, California in Monterey. If you're familiar with that, location. And it's kind of funny now looking back all these years, because it was my first, you know, time in California, and I didn't know what I didn't know. And we're out there in Monterey, California, which is, you know, it's a beautiful area. And our ranges were on like the beach and shooting over the ocean and all of that. And I just thought like, oh, this is like Army stuff. Like, this is what Army people do. And then I quickly realized that it's not like that everywhere else. But yeah, so I started out in the infantry. It was at Fort Ord, California. Spent some time at Fort Lewis, Washington, Fort Campbell, Kentucky. And then about 6 years in is when I began my Special Forces journey. I went to Special Forces Assessment Selection in 1996. Ended up going to the Special Forces Qualification Course in 97 and graduated in 98. And kind of took off from there.
Fantastic. You know, a typical journey for Special Forces, spending some time in the infantry and then learning about kind of what you want to do and then going in at it a little bit older, you know, definitely the Q course, right? And then just a whole series of training pipeline. And then, of course, 9/11 happens as you're, you know, going through that training. And then how did your career change and your commitment to becoming, you know, a senior NCO in the Army as a Green Beret? How did that change and shape you as you continued your career, your Army career?
Yeah, for sure. It's a great question. And, you know, I always read and hear a lot about the guys that were inspired by 9/11. And that's when they entered the service. But for me, being a, I guess, an old timer, you know, I was about 10 years in, 10 to 11 years in the military. And I was, you know, several years into my Special Forces journey. I was actually at an advanced non-commissioned officer course in Fort Bragg, North Carolina, when the terrorist attack happened. So, and I just remember that time period so vividly, because I'm in a classroom setting with Green Berets from all the different groups, the Special Forces groups, to include 5th Special Forces Group, which would go on to be the, you know, famously known as the Horse Soldiers, some of those teams and all of that. So we were all together, all the different groups. And it was interesting to kind of hear the different perspectives, because the group that I was part of was 10th Special Forces Group. And our focus was on the European theater. So we had been busy, you know, pre-9/11, like everybody's forgotten this by now, because the Balkans and Kosovo are kind of like way past memories. But that was a big deal for us, because that was the only show in town, was the Balkans, the air war in Serbia, the Kosovo peacekeeping, and all of those things. Combat search and rescue is what I, that was one of the things I did for the air war. But we were actually busy and active. We were doing a ton of things. And then all of a sudden 9/11 happens. And to my point about the Balkans and, you know, Kosovo and things like that, but it really made it seem like, okay, that is very much on a smaller scale. Like, this is for real. Like, people are going to die. Like, you know, this is going to be for real. I think it was instant that this is very real and this is happening. And it was a very interesting, exciting time in my career. And I think this might surprise a lot of people, but, you know, when you serve and you train and you do things over and over and over again, you know, you aspire to be able to do those things for real. And that's where we were. Now, we didn't get an opportunity to go into Afghanistan initially. But I was part of the initial invasion once Iraq, once that all came about. And I was watching something about you earlier, or I read something about you. I know that you did time in Afghanistan and Iraq. So I envy you a little bit for that, that you got both of those theaters in. But and actually several, was it 2 trips to Iraq, 3 trips to Afghanistan, maybe, is what I heard.
That's correct. Yeah.
So thank you, Amy.
20 years. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, thanks. You know, I was lucky enough, blessed enough to work in a joint environment and alongside with Green Berets and, and even Navy SEALs, and under a NATO command as well, and under JSOC. And so working in that and joint environment with people like you, I mean, it just opened up a whole world to me that I didn't really know about when, in the Marine Corps. And so I learned, I listened, I truly embrace the opportunity to learn about what Green Berets do, like the actual mission, you know, especially in Afghanistan and in Iraq with the village stability operations and the who's who in that community. And so, so much respect and the tightness and the closeness that you guys have. I just wish more people knew about it, but that's why, you know, people like you who go on and spend their whole career in service, and then you get out and you're called to do even greater things. When you thought that that was like the biggest thing that you were ever going to do, little did you know what the plan in store for you was. So, as you went along in your career, learned a lot of leadership lessons through combat operations and, storytelling and, you know, letting your passion fuel your purpose. So once you retired, where did you find yourself? What was your calling after retirement?
So surprisingly enough, I retired, and I'm a self-admitted, I have kind of an unusual background here, kind of an anomaly, a unicorn. I retired out of Fort Bragg, so I spent close to 20 years in special forces, actively in a group and deploying and all of those things, and then of course being an instructor and doing my staff time, because you can't just do all kinds of fun stuff and never like pay the price for it. So I got to do all of those things, spent about 20 years in special forces, retired after 26 and a half years. And ironically enough, a guy that used to work for me was up in the DC area. And I was up there toward the end of my career, and we were doing a surveillance exercise in DC. And I went over to his house for a barbecue, and he was telling me about this new job that he had. He was going to be the global security leader for the new Museum of the Bible that they were building in Washington, D.C. This is back in 2016. Museum of the Bible, $550 million museum, 430,000 square feet, right, 2 blocks south of the Capitol. Excuse me. So he was going to be the global security leader because they had a lot of overseas trips to Israel and looking for artifacts and things like that. And I made a kind of a off the cuff remark to him. I said, "Well, hey man, if you ever need any help, just let me know. Be happy to help out." Well, he thought I was joking because he knew how I felt at that time about DC, and I didn't ever want to live in a big city like that. But he ended up calling me back about a week or two later and said, "Hey man, were you serious about that? Because I really do need some help. Like, I'm focused up and out on the global side. I need someone that I can trust. That's day to day, part of the construction for over a year. I need someone there helping with security and things like that." And I was like, man, the timing just worked out. And my kids were old enough. My son was in college at that point. My daughter was a senior. And you know how it is, Amy, when you're kind of looking at the like, okay, this is the end and what's next, because there's still things I need to pay for and do. So it just kind of all lined up. Even though that's kind of a different transition to go from a Green Beret to a museum person. But that's what I did. And I did that for close to 3 years and got some great experience. It was a big job. I was director of security for about 2 years, and then did some operations. So I was director of operations there. Then I transitioned over to the consultant side at Thornton Tomasetti, engineering firm, and did that for a few years. And they are the ones that allowed me to transfer from DC to Texas. So once I got down to Texas, I had a meeting set up with Chris Cassidy. Chris is the current president and CEO of the National Medal of Honor Museum Foundation. And Chris has a very interesting background. He's a former Navy SEAL. He's a former chief NASA astronaut. He's an Annapolis grad. He's an MIT grad. He's done like three spacewalks. He had a ton of time in space. So he's, you know, he's one of those guys that just make your resume like, okay, I guess I didn't do enough during my time compared to this guy. But, you know, I say all those things about Chris kind of and Jess a little bit, but he's such a humble guy. You would never know that he was a NASA astronaut or a Navy SEAL. And he was he's a decorated Navy SEAL. He's one of the first guys into Afghanistan after the attacks, him and his team. And, you know, he's just such a humble guy. But anyway, Reader's Digest version, I had that meeting with Chris Cassidy back in the fall of 2021. And I had a book and I was going through a list and I said, hey, Chris, these are all the things that we did terrible at the Museum of the Bible, like absolute, we fell on our face. We didn't do such a good job. Here's some things that we did really good. And I was just passing on lessons learned. And to be honest with you, Amy, I wasn't trying to pitch him for a job because I had a job and I was making good money. And I was so like fired up about what he was doing for the Medal of Honor Museum. I just wanted to like support and like, hey, here's some ideas, like free. Like, I'm not trying to, you know, like, oh, hey, hire me for $30,000 a month or whatever. Like, I just wanted to share some lessons learned. And that led to some further conversations. And then he asked me like, hey, would really like for you to come and run operations for us. Would you consider it? And I said, absolutely. And here I am still to this day, 2 years in. So I'm very honored by that. It's great to be working for the foundation for sure.
Well, wonderful. We've seen, you know, just a glimpse as to the construction going on, and obviously fundraising is key, and then it will definitely, no doubt, bring national attention. Are you ready for all that?
Yeah, I believe we are. We spend a lot of time looking at our numbers, our projections, financial projections, guest attendance. So I think we're very well set up to be able to handle, you know, 600,000 to 800,000 folks a year. And, you know, Amy, I'm not for sure how familiar you are with Texas or Arlington, Texas, which is where, you know, the Dallas Cowboys play, AT&T Stadium. It's where the World Series champion Texas Rangers play at Globe Life Field. The old Choctaw Stadium where the Rangers used to play, the outdoor stadium, Six Flags. But our museum is being built right in that area. Like, it's a sweet spot. And they're getting ready to open a 888-room hotel in less than 60 days in that same area. They just announced on December 12th that they're going to be opening up a more luxury style hotel. They're tearing down the old Sheraton and building a more luxury upgraded type of hotel experience with a 735 parking garage, 735 slot parking garage. So this area that we're in is just, it's amazing. There's just tons of people. I mean, there's over 90,000 people that go to the Cowboys games on Sundays. High school football in Texas is played over, you know, the championship games. They're played over 3 or 4 days at AT&T Stadium. They get over 200,000 people to watch the high school state championships in the state of Texas. So those are all our future guests, and we're right there in that sweet spot. You know, we're sitting on 5 acres. The museum's going to be about 100,000 square feet, setting right on a lake, you know, waterfront property. So it's just, we're very well set up. It's a gorgeous location. We couldn't have asked for a better place. We're just very, very fortunate to have Arlington, Texas as our home. But I like to say this, I just want to make sure that this point is very clear. You know, even though our museum's in Texas, in North Texas, we like to say that this is going to be America's museum. It's not just a museum for Texans, but It's for everybody. It's America's museum.
I can see it be drawing even more people to the region. And why was it selected for that particular location? Is there any backstory for the selection of the location?
Yeah, they did a nationwide search. So they looked, I think they looked in San Diego, they looked in Boston, they looked all across the country, and they narrowed it down to two places. It was Denver, Colorado, and Arlington, Texas. That was the two final areas. And Arlington made just such a strong push to get the museum and what they were offering us. You know, like I said, the 5 acres, waterfront property, you're going to be right there by AT&T and Globe Life. All of those things were extra benefits. And they couldn't have given us a better deal on the land. I mean, you just can't get a better deal than what they did for us. And, you know, this is important to know too, Amy. You know, Texas is the second leading state behind your state, California, population. I think you guys are at 39. We just hit 30. So, you know, California, Texas, 1 and 2. And if I may just throw in a little joke, we do get a lot of folks from California that come here to Texas. I'm just saying. But so we have a great population center here. Arlington is strategically located, you know, between Dallas Fort Worth Airport and Dallas Love Field. You know, millions of people are flying in. The Fort Worth Dallas Metroplex, I think it's one of the top five in the country. So I think the hospitality, the donor base, I mean, they looked at all of these different things, and this is obviously pre-Darrell taking a job, but they looked at all of these things, and they thought Arlington, Texas served them the best. And I think they nailed that decision. They nailed it.
Yeah, well, it sounds like it's going to be a real destination for people, not just from America, but even, you know, international from around the world. I've learned a few things in the past few years with my involvement with tourism to Oceanside, California, and what people will come and see and what they want to see. Part of that is the Mount Soledad National Veterans Memorial in La Jolla, California, where I'm on the board of trustees. And
oh, really?
People from around the world come to see that. And that's where we have veteran plaques that are on these beautiful walls. And we've got a beautiful panoramic view around all of San Diego. You can even see the Mexico from high atop Mount Soledad. But it's been wonderful to be a part of that and knowing that the draw is for our veterans and for our troops and paying respect. And so I will be first in line to come down and see when you're doing your opening or your
pre-opening. I appreciate that.
Yeah.
I'd like to check out that museum too. That sounds really interesting.
Yeah, well, it's an outdoor venue and there's plenty of activities and retirement ceremonies, and our two signature events are a Memorial Day and a Veterans Day event. And, you know, we get the mayor, we get senators, we get Congress members to come up and participate in our signature events. And so it's been great. But the executive director is my old sergeant major from the Marine Corps. So when I came back to California, he called me and said, Amy, I need your help on the board. But it's been a great learning experience. And so venues like this that are coming online and, you know, becoming national treasures, it's up to us as like the next generation to be the keepers and bring people in to make it so that people can have a place to remember, you know, especially the Medal of Honor outside of DC, because as you know, living in DC, you know, everything is there, but why not put it accessible to other people who can't make it to the DC area?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up DC. DC, it's, you know, we looked at DC, or they looked at DC, but that's a very challenging market to work with, you know, the bureaucracy, the red tape, obviously, but it takes so long to work through the permits and to do all of those things. And here's something that not a lot of people consider. You know, when you build a museum, in DC. And if you're wanting to be a revenue generating museum, which, you know, you want to make money to support yourself, you're going to be competing against the best museums in the country, and they're all free. So, you know, we were like, hey, we need to be a revenue generating museum. Like, we need to be able to support ourselves. You know, we're still going to have to rely on donors and fundraising and all of those things, like all the other cultural institutions. But, you know, it was like, hey, we want you guys to be self-supporting. And it's very tricky. It's very tough. I think the Spy Museum, they do a really good job. But man, when you're competing against the best museums in the country, and it's like, well, I can go there for free, and why would I pay $20 to go see that museum? Like, it's just tough. And as soon as you start staying in DC, like, you know, Cherry Blossom Festival, it's like such a huge thing there in DC, right? When I lived there for several years, I never went to the Cherry Blossom Festival. I used to drive by the Cherry Blossom, but it was like, when the Cherry Blossom Festival was going on, like, you couldn't do anything. You couldn't go out to dinner. You could barely, you know, navigate through the traffic. It was just like, oh, it's just such a difficult time. So even the people that live there, I think it's hard for them sometimes to get out and do things. But anyway, I think our location, it's going to be easy to get to, easy to get out. And it's going to be something that, you know, we're going to have something for everyone.
Great. And I'm sure the strategic partnerships with the sports and the state and colleges and, you know, as a venue for places. So you're well positioned with all of your leadership background and, you know, your heart and your passion for this and the Medal of Honors, of course, honoring them. But let's talk about your journey. Kind of a rapid fire here. What's the best piece of advice that you ever received? And what would you like to share about that?
Yeah, and I learned this in high school with Coach Thornburg, you know, my National Guard Special Forces football coach. And he just kind of drilled it into us. It's like, work hard, be humble, don't quit. And I didn't know how great that advice was, but it's carried me over. Actually, I was on LinkedIn earlier today, and someone had brought up Ranger School, and they had a picture of some students going through Ranger School, and they were like, hey, what's the best advice that you ever received? And the don't quit was probably, you know, one or two for me, but work hard, be humble, don't quit has really served me well throughout my career, through the ups and downs, because you're going to have ups and downs. You're going to have setbacks and failures. So don't surrender to the setbacks and failure, because you're going to have setbacks and failures. You got to keep going every day.
That's great advice and timeless. Definitely doesn't change with over 40 years since Coach gave that to you. And, you know, I love you bringing up the coach aspect, because, you know, some of these original influencers in our lives, the coaches, the teachers, the people that really shaped us outside the home, outside of our parents, that have such a lasting impact. I could probably name a couple. And playing sports was one of them for me as well, playing tennis, and really positions people and sets people up for success later in life, whether it's in the military or outside. But reaching those people, and he was already in the military, but for them to see the military for the benefits that they want these kids at that age to go on and succeed.
And Amy, I think I know that you get this too, because I follow you on social media, and I know how just, you know, you're always out there and you're doing something, but I think that it's an obligation. Like, we have an obligation. I feel like, my humble opinion, and I feel like you feel the same way, but I feel like we have an obligation. Like, I'm friends with Scott Mann, and he's very successful with his best-selling book, Pineapple Express, and he's got his play, and he's doing all those type of things. And Scott likes to say, like, hey, no one's coming. Like, it's up to us. No one's coming. And I think I take that as an obligation as veterans, that it's up to us to, you know, everybody can go do something. You can go talk to a school, or you could give a speech, or you can volunteer to be part of a board. I did a speech the other day for the Marine Metroplex, I think is what it was called. It was in Dallas, and there was a I think it was an E8. It's been so long. It's been a long time since I've seen like the Marine Corps rank, but I think it was an E8. And he was there with these two young kids, junior ROTC kids from one of the schools in Dallas, and they were, in their Marine uniform. And it was just so neat to see, this very seasoned, experienced Marine, and he's with these two high school kids, in their uniform. And I was just so, I don't know, I was just so caught up into that. I had a couple extra coins with me, some challenge coins, and I called him up there after my speech and gave him a coin. And if that's like a little small token of appreciation that maybe someone remembers later on, that someone was good to them or said something nice to them, because it's really an honor that we still have some youth out there. Because if you listen to the news or read the paper, it's like, oh my gosh, no one's serving. And I know we have some challenges, but I think there's an obligation that we have to try to help out the younger generation, like your tennis coach or my football coach did for us. I think that's important to do.
I couldn't agree more. And veterans, sharing their story can be very therapeutic for them and inspiring the next generation because our own national security is on the line. And so we do need the next generation to be inspired and want to serve. And if not us, then who is going to inspire them to serve? And if we don't have the right people signed up, ready to go, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. So we can't just drop our packs now and focus on us, but we really have to look in the rearview mirror and pull along the next generation. That's, kind of driven me as a vet in the veteran space now that I'm serving in the reserves, but not on full time. We really have to look at ways to get that next generation motivated and hearing stories like you and seeing what's in the possible. And when, for veterans themselves, when one veteran succeeds, we all succeed because that narrative of these veterans who, get out and kind of lose their motivation is really hard to grapple with. So reaching down to the junior generation, the young generation, and then making sure our veterans can stay motivated and go on to reach their maximum potential.
Yeah, agreed.
Because we don't want that to be what younger people see. We want them to see you and we want them to see the other people who go on to great success.
And you, and
Well,
you.
a career after their career is so important. And
Yeah, it
the
really is.
stories, Scott Mann does such a great job and he's followed his passion. And that's really inspired a lot of people, therapeutic to say the least, but framing it and being that voice. And so we can inspire the next generation. But if you could give advice to yourself 30 years ago, what advice would you give yourself if you were just starting your career of all the things you've learned? What would you tell yourself?
There's probably a lot of different things. Don't be such a hard head. And take care of your lower back. If I could go back in time, that would be definitely a really important one. It would probably be find what you love to do and do that. And I think that's so important, regardless of dollar signs and salaries and all of those things. Find what you love to do and do that. Don't chase the money, chase what you're passionate about, because you'll be happy. And I've definitely learned this over the years that, you know what, you could have a $500,000 a year job and be just absolutely miserable, and you don't want to go to work in the morning, or you throw up on the way to work in the morning. Like, what is that really worth? I mean, is it really worth that much money? Because you're just going to be all torn up inside. That person would probably be a lot happier making a lot less money, but actually fired up and like, man, it's money. I can't wait to crush my to-do list. Like, here we go. I think that's an important lesson that people need to know. It's like, don't chase the money. Chase what you're passionate about and do that. You're going to be a lot happier in life.
That's great advice. If anyone's listening out there who ever had the Sunday scaries or the Monday morning blues, which we probably have all had. Luckily, I've been so fortunate, not very often, but on occasion. So, like you said, finding your passion so you don't have those feelings, if you've ever had that before, where you're just like, I cannot go to this job. I do not want to go to work. If you like, you've had maybe had that in your life, you've been in situations where you just have to take action to make a change.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So for those starting their career, that's great advice too. But what other advice would you give someone who is just starting out? What would be advice you give them?
Still go back to the work hard, be humble, don't quit. I think that's important. I've already said that one though, so I don't want to cheat, but just to make sure they balance their work and home life. Don't just go all in. A lot of people just go all in on the job and they kind of forget themselves. And that is a big mistake. I'd like to share that and actually be a little bit vulnerable here. But you know, I didn't know like how civilians worked. So when I retired from the Army, I mean, you know, you get institutionalized and you're used to the Army. And I made this mistake because I just wanted to be such a hard charger. And I was like, man, I'm worth it. I'm worth what you guys are paying me. I'm going to work hard. And I was single at the time. You know, my son was in college. My daughter was finishing up her high school year. So I just went all in on my job and I forgot about myself. Like I have to take care of myself. My workouts were reduced and, I was just spending, I was consumed with my job and consumed with work and I was always there. And I regret that, you know, looking back on that time period, because I did have, you know, my back started hurting, some of those things. And it took someone to be like, man, are you all right? Cause I would do like kind of that lower back, that old man kind of stretch. And, you know, I just think that's an important lesson. Like you can't go all in and just forget about everything else. You can't forget about your family. You can't forget about yourself. Like all of those things are so important. You got to have a good balance.
Yeah. Prioritizing your health, your future self will thank you if you know how to prioritize that and don't feel that you're being selfish. That's the one thing I regret. I always felt selfish if I go to the gym or if I take time to go for a run and work out or something.
Yeah, I have to, me and my wife, we have these same conversations now because she kind of feels that way because, you know, she works from home and, you know, she's got a busy family life and things like that. So and she's got some little people running around that she takes care of from time to time. So she kind of feels guilty about that. It's like, you should prioritize. So yeah. we're getting better, both of us.
Yeah, that's great advice though. So talking about professional achievements, what's the one or two things that you're most proud of in your career for professional achievements?
Yeah, excuse me. I'd say for the pinnacle for special forces, enlisted. I wasn't an officer, I was enlisted. I'd say the pinnacle for a special forces operator is to lead a special forces operational detachment alpha, to lead an ODA. And it's even more special if you get to lead an ODA in combat. And that's one of the things that I'm most proud of, that I had that opportunity. I had that privilege to lead a team of special forces operators in combat. In Baghdad during some really crazy time periods. My first team sergeant rotation was 8 months in 2006, right there in Baghdad in Adamia, and it was absolutely just crazy. And then I got to do a team sergeant rotation in 2007 in Baghdad as well at the Baghdad International Airport. We were doing a lot of human intelligence type stuff, some intel work. But that was an absolute privilege for me. It was a great opportunity. 2006, we were the best Special Forces team and all of 10th Special Forces Group, which is a very, very prestigious honor. It's something that they do every year. It's a competition. Out of all of the teams, 50, 60 teams, maybe even more now since they've increased. But it was just an absolute, you know, the competition is so tough because everybody is in combat. I mean, everybody, it's like, you know, I mean, everybody is doing great things and they're at the tip of the spear and, you know, the competition couldn't have been tougher. And we won the 2006 Larry Thorne Award for the best operational detachment alpha in all 10th group. And it just blew me away. And then we were actually second place the next year. So I'm very, very proud of that. Obviously that wasn't me. That was a whole team that pulled together to do that. And I just had the privilege of leading that team. But that was just, man, that was just an absolute honor. Still makes me proud to this day.
Oh, that's fantastic. And, you know, you mentioned 2006 in Iraq and Baghdad. And
how crazy that
reminds me, yes, for you just couldn't even, you couldn't imagine it. And you can try to explain it to someone, but there's just no way to really grasp just how dangerous it was, how restive it was. It was just absolutely that, you know, so I was there all of 2006 as well in Anbar province. And, you know, I stay in touch with that team that I was with working in public affairs and Marine Corps command under an army command in Baghdad. So we made it to Baghdad a couple times, but just anyone who was there during that time, you and I know exactly what was going on because it was such an emotional roller coaster. I mean, of people.
Well, do you remember this, Amy? Do you remember this? Like our rotation in 2006, we got there in January of 2006 and we were there January, I think, to August. So, you know, January in Baghdad, it was like, okay, well, this is because I had two previous rotations and they were both up north. The first time I was up north with the Kurdish Peshmerga for the initial invasion. So we were up in the Erbil, Mosul, you know, northern Iraq. Second rotation, I was on the Iranian border, east of Bakuba, at a little KMTB, Kirkuk military training base. So I knew that first month, like, okay, this is way different from the previous rotations. But if you recall this, February 22nd, 2006, the Samarra Shrine got bombed. And it ignited a civil war in Iraq between the Shia and the Sunni. And I mean, they were killing each other. And then the only thing it seemed like they agreed on was they hated us. They hated Americans. So it was a very, very violent, violent, deadly time period for sure. No doubt.
Absolutely. It was. And we just couldn't even keep up with the memorials for our troops, you know, and that's probably one of my biggest regrets too, is not going to the memorials that I could have, but I was said I was too busy or I had other assignments or work to do. It's probably
just, I can't believe you just said that because I have the same regret. I have the same regret. And it was, for me, it was just like, it was like, gosh, I would probably just do better if I didn't go. It would keep me stronger, but like my heart would just kind of pour out. The couple that I did go to, yeah, those are tough. And I have that same regret, Amy. I really do. I have that same regret. I don't think I've ever admitted to that or said that publicly, but I have that same regret.
Yes. You know, and it was General Odenaro who came out to Anbar and said, how many of you didn't go to the 19-year-old's, you know, memorial service just because you didn't know him? And you don't have to know someone to go and pay your respects. And so that's my biggest regret of and not taking as many pictures as I wanted to. But I know how that feeling of regret or the tremendous loss of life on all sides, always and every way for the Iraqis as well. And so coming out of that, really emerging with what's left of your, you know, emotions and your time to, what are you going to do with your life? What are you going to, how are you going to, you know, bounce back emotionally, console those who need to, you know, work on their mental health and kind of emerge from that and, you know, go on to serve. But what do you think has been the best way for you to kind of put that in a box or put it in perspective so that others listening maybe can take your lead and how you've really just managed to overcome some of the sadness and regrets and live a full, rich life after service?
Yeah, well, I think I definitely compartmentalized a lot while I was in the service. And I think that was just a survival mechanism. Like, you know, you had to kind of compartmentalize some things when you're seeing, you know, for us, I know in 2007, it was part of our daily flow. You know, we were looking at KIAs and wounded in action and, you know, double amputee, triple amputee. I mean, we were seeing all of those things, and man, that weighs heavy. And especially for us, because we were doing, like I said, we were doing a lot of the human intelligence and targeting. And it's like, man, we got to get these guys. I mean, they're killing our brothers and sisters every day. We got to get after this. And we felt a lot of pressure. But I would say, Amy, for me, the thing that's helped me the most, and it's so funny, the thing that helps me the most is walking on the treadmill. Because I've had some hip issues and I can't run anymore at all. And I'm past the point where it's like, hey, this treadmill walking is really like, it's doing more like mentally than it is physically for me. Like it's more for my mental well-being. And I think that's what's really, really helped me, is kind of having that outlet and being able to still work out, even though I can't run anymore. That's just something that's really helped me. And, I'd say over this past year, I've done a lot of writing, like journal type stuff, reflecting on the 2006 rotation. So I didn't realize until just recently how therapeutic that was to put some of my thoughts down on paper. And then, you know, also calling the guys on the team that I served with and saying, hey, did you know, what do you remember from this day? Like April 17, 2006 was a big day for us. We were in a 2-hour firefight daylight in downtown Adamia, which is crazy. But talking to the guys on the team is like, hey, what did you see? And everybody has like a different perspective. So that's been very therapeutic for me. It's really helped me. And then talking to someone about it, a friend has been very helpful for sure.
Yeah, that's great advice. I love that when people write stuff down, and we all feel better when we can just write it down, put it away for a bit, but recall some of those things that fuzzy now a little bit with some clarity. But how about one of your biggest regrets from a professional perspective? What would you say something you regretted?
Yeah. And I still regret it to this day. I mean, there's no excuse. I could knock it out. I should knock it out. But so, you know, to be a special forces soldier, you got to have a language. And I'm not blaming the West Virginia educational system on this. This is me. I'm taking responsibility for it. It wasn't the West Virginia curriculum. But I never was exposed to a foreign language. And yes, they do teach foreign languages in West Virginia, but I was never exposed. And part of a special forces soldier, like part of your job, like you have to learn a foreign language. And I spent 4 months trying to learn German. And it was just super tough for me. It was really tough. I wasn't used to it. And, you know, I had a lot of difficulty. And I was actually stationed in Germany for my first 4 years of my special forces career. 1998 to 2002, I was in Stuttgart, Germany. Although that is a little misleading because we were always deployed to the Balkans or Kosovo. But I remember getting over there, and my sister and brother-in-law were at a little place called Hohenfels. So you know, me and my wife at that time, we were like in the city in Stuttgart. And then my sister and my brother-in-law were kind of like in the country, Germany. And we would go to each other's houses. They'd get the city, we'd get the country life and all that. But I remember one of the first times we got together and we went out like downtown Stuttgart. And my sister was like, "Hey, Mr. German guy, you know, go ask one of these Germans like where the bathroom is." And I tried to do it. And the guy just looked at me like, "What are you talking about? Like, no idea." And I always regret that because it really kind of like put me in a shell a little bit. And I should have just let it go. Like, okay, I need to work on this. But that's my biggest professional regret, is not buckling down, not taking that more serious. Even if we, you know, we still had Iraq and all of that stuff. And obviously German wasn't a big thing then, but I wish that I would have continued to try to improve that and work on that and get that down, because I would be fluent by now, probably. That's my biggest professional regret from my time in the military.
Yeah, good advice to someone else who's, you know, listening to.
Yeah, go learn that language.
Definitely. Now, how about your top three tips for a successful life? What would you tell someone?
I think that we've covered some of them. Invest in yourself, take care of yourself. You got to have fun and stay positive. I'm working on a speech that I'm going to give in mid-January. And one of my lessons is keep your internal voice positive. You know, convince yourself that you can do it. Don't quit. Don't surrender. And convince yourself that you're built different, you know. And I think that's so important, you know, to keep that internal voice positive. Don't beat yourself up. You know, you got to face yourself in the mirror. Like, you want to build that person up. You don't want to tear that person down.
Yeah, great advice. You can be your own best or worst enemy.
Yeah, right.
Out there. So we talked about what's next, but I would love for you to share, you know, what challenges are you coming up on? You mentioned some public speaking. What big adventure or trip or something you're going to tackle come this year in 2024?
Yeah. So like I said earlier, this is the last year before the museum opens in 2025. So I know it's just going to be Donkey Kong crazy trying to get the museum ready to open up. And there's a lot of things that you do on the backside that are like way behind the scenes, you know, back of house type stuff, like facilities and, you know, changing out the light bulbs and having attic stock for, you know, theater seating. I mean, there's just so much that goes into that and making sure you have enough storage space. But so this year I'm going to really spend a lot of time on that and get it ready for the people that are going to operate it in 2025. Continuing on the professional side, then I'm going to mention a couple personal things, but, I shared with you before we went live, but I very much came to this job as an introvert. You know, I started back in February 2022 and kind of like under the cloak of a special forces guy, the quiet professional, and, you know, don't brag, be humble and have a lot of humility. I'm still that guy, but I was probably a little bit, probably too much of that person. Actually, I had a mentor that was helping me on my way out the door, and she was helping me with interviewing and all that stuff. And she said, "Darrell, like, I appreciate that you're very humble. Like, you're a very humble man. Like, I get that. That's really cool. But you're almost to the point where it's self-deprecating. And Darrell, you got to know this. When you leave the Army and you leave Special Forces and leave the Green Berets, like, these people that you're going to be talking to, that are going to be interviewing you, the civilians, they don't know that you were a Green Beret or Special Forces, you know, like, they don't know your reputation or your experience. Like, you have to sell yourself. So you need to come out of that shell." Long story short there, being an introvert, you know, I started doing a lot more speaking engagements and practicing delivery and those things. So I'm very excited about that. I have two big speeches coming up in mid-January that I'm really excited about. So I'm looking forward to that. And And I'm listening to David Goggins actually in February. He's going to be, David Goggins is a huge name in the special ops community, former Navy SEAL. I'm going to listen to him in February in Dallas and kind of see how he does it. Now, on the personal side, my wife and I will be married 5 years in 2024 this year. So we're going to go to Turks and Caicos and really looking forward to that. And then my second piece of personal adventures, challenges, my daughter and daughter-in-law are expecting a little girl. So that's going to be super exciting.
Wow, first grandbaby for you? Wow.
I inherited some grandchildren from my wife's side, but from my son, yes.
Yes. Well, good. Lots of changes and new, adventures. I love hearing about people's travel, especially international travel. I think that inspires learning and growth and stepping just outside your comfort zone, even if it's to Turks and Caicos. But getting on that plane with your passport in hand, we always take a risk, but it's a good adventure. It means you're still alive, you're still ready to go, you want to see something new. That's fantastic.
Balancing work and home life. Yep.
Yeah, getting out of the staycation
Yeah.
mindset, right? Now, of course, the causes that you care about of the Medal of Honor Museum that you're working so hard on, we'll share that in the show notes. But any other causes or passion projects that you'd like to share?
I mean, anything veteran causes. I get hit up a lot on LinkedIn as, I think probably influencer is probably too aggressive for me. I don't feel like I'm an influencer, but I do get hit up with like, oh, hey, I'd like to tell you about this type of treatment for TBI or PTS and things like that. Hey, what do you think about this? Or so any of the veterans causes out there. I mean, I think there's a lot of just great patriotic loving Americans that want to do things. So I try to help out with some of those causes. Special Forces Association, Special Forces Foundation, those are easy ones to help out. The Special Operations Charitable Trust did something with them last year. So I haven't really like narrowed it down to like, hey, this is the one that I want to like pursue, because there's so many out there. Like you could literally choose from hundreds. But I'd say the Special Forces Association and the Foundation are probably the bigger ones. Definitely my heart goes out on the TBI PTS side, because I've lived that. I know what that is. So
Well,
yeah, those are big
yeah.
ones.
Yeah, those are great. We'll link to those as well. So you mentioned that the TBI and some therapy. What's your thought on the new sort of exploring alternative therapies that are out there?
Well, I'm gonna mispronounce this. That's why I try to stay away from it. But someone had reached out to me recently. My most recent connection was with the hyper barbaric therapy, chamber therapy, or whatever that is. I don't know how to pronounce it, but it sounded really interesting, and I think they're having a lot of success with that. I would probably, I'm more conservative. So I would probably like gravitate towards that before I would look into like the mushrooms and all that. And I'm not talking negative about any of that stuff. If it's helping our veterans, awesome. I just don't know enough about it, and I'd be too scared to do it. But I did think it was fascinating that I guess they do like 40 treatments, and it's really helping out a lot of people. So I wanted to learn more, and I was telling the person that I was talking to, it's like, hey, it'd be hard for me to promote something that I haven't done. So maybe I could do a couple and at least be able to pronounce it better and be able to be a better advocate for it.
Sure. Well, some of these psychedelic treatments are doing out of the country.
Yeah.
Ibogaine is something you might hear about in the future, but there's been some real progress being made out there. So it's been very interesting to learn about. But As we come to a close, if people want to reach out to you and connect with you, what would be, say, the best way or your platform of choice?
Probably I'm more comfortable with LinkedIn because I've done LinkedIn longer. And there's not a lot of me on LinkedIn. You can find me pretty easy. It's Darrell, Darrell, last name's Utt. And I'm happy to connect, with most people, as long as you don't have like one connection and you're trying to sell me some cosmetics or something, or you're like a beautiful person and you're like, hey, want to go out on a date or something. Like, I don't do that weird stuff, but, happy to connect on LinkedIn. I'm also on Instagram and Twitter and Facebook now. Starting to do a little bit more posts on that. So yeah, happy to connect. Just send out a connection, and hopefully people enjoy this podcast. And hopefully it's going to be super popular. But if you want to hear more about me and my background and some of my stories, if you're into the combat stories and things like that, I would say probably my most popular, well, it is the most popular podcast for me. If you go to YouTube and you type in Combat Story episode 74, I did a podcast with Ryan Fugit and he does a great job. That's probably the most popular podcast that I've ever done. Just a ton of people tune in for that one. I don't know why, but they like it.
I love that podcast and he's great. He does such a great job. And so we will link to that as well. I love what he's done with that. And
yeah,
yes. And I just so happy to see his success with that.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's very,
can I just say, I'd like to throw out just kind of like a little teaser for 2024. You know, I'm wearing you see I'm wearing Rowdy 7, and you can see a patch behind me that says Rowdy 7. So Rowdy 7 was my call sign in 2006 in Baghdad. So if someone was calling over the radio for Rowdy 7, they were calling for me. Just a little teaser, I would stay tuned this year. You might hear a little bit more about Rowdy 7. Hopefully we can make an announcement in a couple of months of something super exciting. Not quite ready yet, but stay tuned. Hopefully you'll hear more about Rowdy 7 in the near future.
Excellent. I love it. We will. And we'll link in the show notes. And Darrell Utt, I can't thank you enough for your time and your wisdom, sharing it here with us on the Victory Podcast. And so we will be in touch with you and follow
Please.
You and look forward to hearing more about your journey at the Medal of Honor Museum. So thank you so much for joining us here.
You can find other episodes of the Victory Podcast on social media by connecting with us on Instagram, LinkedIn, and YouTube.